This video is sponsored by ExpressVPN, which is almost as fast as I think I am. Cycling is a beautiful sport. It's one man on his mechanical machine, going as fast as possible on the open roads, with nothing backing him up except his willpower. 50 personnel, and a dozen teammates who are there to hard carry right until the end, so he can win. But road racing and grand tour riding isn't the topic for today, because we're here to talk about cycling, which isn't the same thing. We're here to talk about what happens when you, an everyday citizen of the sidewalk, decides to buy a bike, and it's one of three things. You become a commuter, you become a cyclist, or you sell it on Craigslist after a month and see if something else works. Regardless of which camp you fall into, the first step of buying a new bike is always the same, which is to gain at least 50 pounds, because the more obese you are when you buy a new bike, the more upvotes you'll get when you take a picture with it. So once you've got some mad Reddit karma, what you might notice in the real world is that while cyclists don't consider themselves commuters, most commuters do consider themselves cyclists. And while most pedestrians and drivers think they're all the same as well, it's really not the case. Simply put, commuters ride bicycles as a means to an end, for going to the grocery store and back again, or to get them to and from work each day. This contrasts starkly with the cyclist, who doesn't go to and from work anymore because he quit his job to have more time on the bike, living solely off the college fund for his kids he'll never have after his wife divorced him. The commuter is someone who always lives in fear, and every day he walks to the bike rack thinking to himself, "Oh man, I hope my bicycle hasn't been stolen again." Whereas despite not owning a lock to save weight, the cyclist does not fear his bike will be stolen, because that would mean the thief would have to wait until he got off the bike first, which hasn't happened for years. Unlike the commuter, the cyclist does not fear vehicles, as he has come to terms with his own mortality. That if his life were to end after a middle-aged mother in an SUV T-bones his cervello while he's running a red light on the way to the start line of his local Cat 3 crit, so be it. A life of safety, that is to say, the life of a commuter, requires an ultimate sacrifice. And that sacrifice is speed. A sacrifice that no cyclist would ever make, instead risking his own collarbones and supple skin to the harsh reality of the pavement. In fact, there's only one thing that a true cyclist fears, and that is the fear of nature itself. More specifically, winds over 10 kilometers an hour coming from the front and or sideward direction. Accordingly, the first dictum of cycling is clear. Aero is everything. In fact, the cyclist will, and must, do everything in his wallet to ensure that he and his bicycle are as light and aerodynamic as possible. And that means the cyclist must abide by the following checklist. Bicycle. Exactly 6.8 kilograms as per UCI regulations. The cyclist has not ridden in any UCI sanctioned events, but has met several people who have visited Europe. Protective gear. While cycling is certainly low impact on your knees, it's not low impact on your skull. Hence why cyclists need to have this. A tiny brain, which they use to avoid traffic that will kill them instantly under any form of contact. Legs, shaved. Arms, shaved. Face, beard. Body, T-Rex. Clothing, white lycra to exert dominance over the peloton with your massive bulge, black lycra on recovery rides to arouse subtle intrigue. All other rides must be performed in light wash cutoff jeans. Saddlebag. Absolutely not. A saddlebag is not aero. Just get your domestique, aka anyone else on the group ride, to carry your extra shit. Power meter. One to measure your bike, and one to measure the power level of other cyclists. Now, one of the most important parts of being on a bike is being on Strava, which tracks your rides and lets you compete with your friends. And while this is all well and good, a true cyclist of course doesn't have any friends, using Strava only to compare his wattages to real professionals and to see when Puck Moonen is within Tinder radius of a cafe and a bike rack. Now, if you're not a cyclist, at this point you might be thinking, "Oh my god, my husband recently bought a bike off Craigslist, but I thought we were a good couple. I just want to have a life together, to have kids together. Is he just going to be away all the time as I raise the children by myself? Their only memory of their father being the weekend he came home to teach them to ride a bike without training wheels?" And no, you're getting way ahead of yourself, because once again, a cyclist would never have kids in the first place, as pregnant women are not aero. And while becoming a cyclist is something we can all aspire to achieve, it is important to point out that if you're still young, don't try to rush it. Most true cyclists are in fact well into their 40s or even 50s. And you might be thinking, "Wait, isn't that well past my physical prime? And yes, it certainly is. But being a cyclist isn't about athletic ability. Being a cyclist is about being at an age where you can quit your dental practice and still have the money to fly to Alpe d'Huez with your lightweight climbing bike so you can take a helicopter to the top and only do the descents. Leave the Tour de France and Olympic track cycling to the kids, who ride their bike purely as a means of self-suffering, hoping they may one day get to keep one of the $15,000 custom bikes their sponsors force them to ride. Alas, they will not, because those bikes have a weight limit of about 270 pounds, and you wouldn't be a real cyclist if you didn't take up every ounce. Unfortunately, while the sport of tour riding is still tainted by the drug scandal of Lance Armstrong and competitors are monitored more closely than ever before, such is not the case for the cyclist, who lives a life of freedom, ordering as many over-the-counter steroids from Egypt as he pleases, writing it off as a business expense, and doping his blood until it's indistinguishable from his Aunt Jemima energy gel. Because unlike his peers, the cyclist is a risk-taker, a visionary, an achiever, and knows that he must do whatever it takes to finish middle of the pack at the annual charity 60 miler. Now, if you're looking to truly immerse yourself in cycling culture, you can try out our sponsor ExpressVPN, which allows you to securely reroute your IP address to over 150 locations in 90 different countries with just one click. I personally use it to reroute my IP to the UK, so when I virtually ride in London on Zwift, I literally am virtually in London. Alternatively, you can stay on your couch and browse Netflix or any streaming service from whatever country you want, letting you bypass any location restrictions with all your personal information safely encrypted. Additionally, ExpressVPN has 24/7 customer support, which you can use for technical questions or just when you're going through hard times. So if you'd like to try out the service and see how you can get 3 months for free, you can go to expressvpn.com/casuallyexplained, or you can click the link in the description below.